My secondary reason for being here, and I will build to the primary, my secondary reason for being here is to promote this new show that I'm doing January 1st on Home and Garden called Living with Ed. It's a wonderful show about what it's like to live with an environmental zealot like me. It's told from my wife's point of view. It's kind of like Green Acres for 2006. Hopefully it's amusing. We'll get a lot of people to watch, and Home and Garden was the right choice because people watch Home and Garden than they do. It's the best channel for that, and we want people to buy solar ovens and do more composting and do more energy efficiency and get electric cars or electric bikes or all that stuff. So that's what I'm here to promote, hence the shameless hucksterism with the T-shirt and the hat, you know. January 1st, thank you for asking, on Home and Garden. Your cash will be available to you later. Home and Garden, thank you. Oh, my God. I'll stop now. Enough already with me. Also, I'm here to promote my friends that will be involved with that show. Phoenix Motor Cars has a wonderful car available next year for $45,000, a terrific car with these ALT CAR nano batteries, exciting new battery technology, lithium ion, without the graphite, without the heat problems. Check that out while you're here, too. ALT CAR nano and Phoenix Motor Cars, terrific. And iZip bikes, these terrific electric bikes that you can pedal, which I like to do. I prefer to pedal and get the workout. Or if you want a little help as you get to my age, I'm 57, some people want a little boost, and you can get a little help while pedaling. So check those booths out, iZip and Phoenix Motor Cars and ALT CAR nano batteries. So that's, as I said, the secondary reason. The primary reason is to introduce a friend, and a good friend. He's been a friend for so long, from Environment Now. He's done so much to clean up Santa Monica Bay, and then he went on to work in Sacramento at the highest level, working to clean up amounts of pollution in the California air basin that I could never dream of cleaning up. How about 75 tons of air pollution? And can you hear me okay? I'll get close to the mic. Thank you, sir. Thank you for getting me back on track. This dear friend thought about doing something we have been trying to do. We in the environmental community were trying to regulate these small engines that create a great deal of pollution, these little tiny engines, and people at Briggs & Stratton said, you can't do it. We'll lose hundreds and hundreds, thousands of jobs. It'll be terrible. And somehow he found the pressure point. The people at Honda said they could do that. Why could the people at Honda do it when the people at Briggs & Stratton couldn't? Well, of course, they could do it. 75 tons of air pollution taken out of the California air because of this man and many other wonderful things he did. He's a great friend. He's a hero. And he's got a book coming out called Lives Per Gallon, The True Cost of Our Addiction to Oil. Welcome, please, my dear friend, Terry Tamminen.
Thank you very much, Ed, and thanks to all of you for being here. Can you all hear me in the back? All right, I'll speak up because I know that sound is an issue, and I am going to be talking about lives per gallon. But first, I want to talk about Ed. Before Ed leaves the room, I want you all to know, first of all, he's my hero for a lot of reasons, because as you'll see on his new show, and by the way, did he mention he's got a new show, Living with Ed, starting January 1st on the Home and Garden Channel? Did he mention that? If he didn't... This is a guy who 15 years ago installed compact fluorescents in his home, and I'll bet he'll tell you that most of them, if not all of them, are still in use. They lasted so long that he's named every single one of them. Before he had kids, he had compact fluorescents. But more importantly, I want to tell you about Ed, and this is a little-known story, and he's always asked me to keep this quiet, but I'm going to tell you because you're really the people that are going to help this revolution to a better planet, so I want you to know the truth about Ed. 30 years ago, he and Arnold were buddies, you know, working out in the gym every day, and Arnold had won Mr. Universe 7 times and had just made his first couple of movies, and Ed was just beginning his career, and they're there pumping away, and Ed says to Schwarzenegger, he says, Arnold, you know, I'm thinking about my career and what I ought to do. I'm either going to go into acting or I'm going to go into bodybuilding like you have. And I'm wondering if you think that I've got the physique to be Mr. Universe even once, let alone 7 times. So Arnold looked at his abs and his pecs and his glutes, especially his glutes, and he said, you know, Ed, I think you should try acting. And so he was kind of crestfallen, but he thought, all right, maybe that's the best direction. And so they go back to pumping iron, and after a few minutes, Arnold thought, well, you know, he was nice enough to ask advice. Maybe I should ask his advice for career advice. So Arnold turns to Ed, and he says, You know, Ed, I'm thinking about becoming an action movie star in Hollywood, and I wonder if you've seen my first three movies, Pumping Iron, Hercules in New York, and Conan the Barbarian. Do you think I have a future in Hollywood? Well, Ed is, if anything, he's honest. And so he said, Arnold, you have about as much chance of succeeding in Hollywood as you do of being governor of California. So anyway, Ed, I'm sorry, the truth is out. The reason we have Arnold as governor is because of you. And there we go, yes, absolutely. Because no matter what political party you're from, and I'm not here to talk about Schwarzenegger, but I am here to let you know that whatever party you're from, he has immeasurably improved the environment in California. The things that Ed was kind enough to attribute to me when I was at the Secretary of EPA and working in the Schwarzenegger administration, none of those things could have been done. The hydrogen highway, the reducing pollution from small engines, the $140 million a year in permanent funding to the Carl Moyer program, which is the cleanest, cost-effective way of converting diesels to clean natural gas and other clean alternative fuels, and now, of course, our climate program. All of that stuff, it's one thing for a guy like me to dream it up. It's another thing to have someone, a governor of the state of California, the sixth largest economy on the planet, actually implement it. So again, I know there's probably people of all parties here, some who voted for him, some who didn't. It's not about the politics, because there's no D or R next to the names of our children. And with that in mind, I want to talk to you a little bit about some of the things that I learned in writing this book, Lives Per Gallon, The True Cost of Our Oil Addiction. But let me first frame my remarks to you today in the form of a question. How do you define patriotism? Do you define patriotism by the flags of our fathers on foreign shores in World War II? Do you define it by the footfall of Neil Armstrong on the moon, after President Kennedy so epically dedicated us to go there and back by the end of that decade? Or do you define patriotism as Mark Twain did when he said that patriotism is the last refuge of a scoundrel, usually signified by he who talks the loudest? Of course, we saw a lot of that in this last election campaign. Well, however it's been defined in the past, I propose to you that we need to redefine patriotism in the 21st century. And that nothing would be more patriotic than kicking our addiction to oil and ending the use of petroleum within our lifetime. And some people would say to me, well, Terry, look, there's no question that it's important to end oil pollution and oil end our addiction, but come on, patriotic? Why is it patriotic to do that? Well, I want to share with you a few quotes from the book that have led me to believe that there is nothing that is more patriotic than doing this, because there is nothing that has harmed our sense of self, our sense of who we are as Americans. There's nothing that has so altered not only our physical landscape and our health and our economic landscape, but the way we're viewed around the world than our dependence on oil. And there are many of these costs, as I document in the book, that can be measured. You can actually put a dollar value on them. But there are many more which are far beyond our poor power to add or subtract. Let me share a few of those with you first. Kids like me with asthma, during ozone days, I will almost always have an asthma attack if I go outside, testified 8-year-old Kyle Dammitz in December of 2002 at a US EPA hearing on proposed diesel standards that would include reducing emissions from school buses. On good days, I take 2 pills in the morning and 3 pills at bedtime. I do an IV treatment every 2 weeks. On a bad asthma day, I take 4 pills in the morning, more at lunch, and again more at bedtime. I came here today to ask you to help. If you make our air cleaner, I will be able to live longer. Now, those cleaner standards for diesel-powered buses and trucks were ultimately adopted by the US EPA, but only over the strong objection of the American Petroleum Institute and numerous engine and auto manufacturers. Yes, the oil companies and the auto companies opposed those cleaner standards, despite the fact that they knew that 100,000 people die prematurely in this country every single year from petroleum air pollution. And 6.5 million more have asthma and other respiratory diseases from completely preventable petroleum air pollution. and many of those are our children and our elders, the most vulnerable among us. They opposed those new standards despite the fact they knew that children who grow up near a busy urban freeway lose 1% of their lung function every single year. And they didn't just say, well, look, we're concerned about the cost and leave it at that. Here's what they said in opposing those modest regulations to reduce pollution from things like diesel school buses. One gentleman said, it is incomprehensible why the US EPA is seeking to tighten the standard for ozone and particulate matter. That gentleman was named Andy Card. At the time, he represented the auto industry. He went on to be the chief of staff of President Bush. Incomprehensible, he said. What's incomprehensible about 6.5 million cases of asthma? His colleague, Paul Bailey, from the American Petroleum Institute, said, the effects that are typically seen are very short-term and very reversible, and people exposed to ozone usually adapt to it. 100,000 premature deaths seems a rather severe form of adaptation, if you ask me. Another one of their colleagues, Richard Klimsch, an auto industry representative, said, you know, what we're talking about here is a temporary loss of lung function of 20 or 30%. That's not really a health effect. Another of their colleagues said, people can protect themselves. They can avoid jogging. Asthmatic kids like Kyle need not go out and ride their bikes. But perhaps the prize for the most direct oil industry lobbyist goes to the one who said that the statistics of elderly people dying early from petroleum air pollution should not be counted, because these are people who were going to die anyway. That's what the oil industry and the auto industry think of you. Now, we all know that it's not just healthcare that suffers in this country, but the environment. You wouldn't be here if you didn't already know that. If, when I say Exxon Valdez, if you didn't already have a picture that comes to mind. But when we talk about the true cost of our oil addiction, it isn't just the cost that we are paying. And you could argue, well, as long as we're paying the cost, okay, fair enough, that's a trade-off. What about the cost that is borne by people we will never meet? You know, when you think about oil production, you think about Saudi Arabia and wealthy sheiks driving their Mercedes Benzes to their great palaces in the desert. The reality is far different. Much of our oil today comes from places like Nigeria and Ecuador and other third world countries where the people who dig it out of the ground or live in the places where that's going on suffer immeasurable harm so that we can power our lifestyle. Let me read to you one short passage, and I'll warn you in advance, this is hard to listen to. Upstream from the Ecuadorian port of Esmeraldas, a 1998 landslide broke two major oil pipelines, sending oil and gas cascading down rivers and into streets. A spark set off an inferno, which devoured cars and homes. People were burned alive. Frantic parents put their children into wooden canoes and pushed them into the Esmeraldas River, and then watched in horror as fire engulfed the river and the children. Locals now call petroleum the excrement of the devil. The majority of the oil produced in Ecuador is exported to refineries in Los Angeles and San Francisco. So the next time you or a friend pumps gasoline into your petroleum-powered car, think not only of the fumes that you are inhaling that are shortening your life, but think about the children who used to live along the Esmeraldas River. And lest you think that that was just one very unfortunate accident, I urge you to read my book, not just because I'd like to sell copies of the book, but because there are countless other examples of how indigenous populations suffer unspeakable horror so that we can put gasoline into our cars. And these, of course, are the costs that are impossible to measure. But there are many, as I said, which are easy to measure. And in the book, I talk about the fact that, for example, we spend $113 billion every single year in tax breaks and other federal subsidies to oil and gas and the auto industry, to some of the richest corporations in the history of commerce. $113 billion. Last August, when President Bush signed the Energy Policy Act of 2005, with a stroke of a pen, He added $6 billion to that total in new subsidies and new tax breaks for the oil and gas industry. We spend almost $700 billion a year in health care costs. Some of that comes out of your pocket as taxpayers, just as it did when we were subsidizing the health care costs related to tobacco and smoking. Some of it comes out of your pocket when you pay your health care premiums, because private insurance companies obviously have to pay for asthma and lung disease and cancer that is directly related to our petroleum addiction. So nearly $700 billion a year in tangible out-of-pocket costs. In my book, I don't get into the hard-to-quantify stuff like, say, lost productivity from a worker who suffers from asthma. There's too wide a range of numbers, although that is a legitimate cost as well. But I'm talking about things that you can actually find on a balance sheet somewhere. Billions of dollars more in crop damage. You wouldn't think about that, but the reality is, just as ozone and other air pollution attacks our lungs, it attacks plant matter. And so in the Central Valley here in California, we have farmers and the UC system that have documented that farmers lose as much as one-third of their crop every year to completely preventable petroleum air pollution. We have billions more in loss to our national monuments, where air pollution is eating them away, and more to our forests. The list goes on and on. And what's the total? About $1 trillion every single year in subsidies to the richest corporations in the history of commerce. And I say that advisedly, because last quarter, Chevron, a California oil company, recorded over $5 billion in quarterly profits, the highest in its history. And in the same quarter, ExxonMobil recorded profits of nearly $11 billion for 1 3-month period. Not revenues, profits. That was the largest quarterly profits in the history of commerce. And we are still giving these companies $1 trillion a year in subsidies. What does that equate to? It's $2,700 for every man, woman, and child in America every year. What would you do with a check for $2,700 if it arrived in your mailbox today? Well, that's one idea. Raise your hand if you would turn around and endorse that check and give it to an oil company. I doubt that any of us would. And you know what we could do with that kind of money? That $1 trillion would provide health insurance for the 45 million Americans who have none, and it would build 1,500 schools in every state of the union every single year. Now, whatever it is that you would do with it, I would imagine that you could figure out something better to do with it. So you would say to me, Terry, how did we get into this mess? How could we possibly pay this terrible price in lives going around the world with our armies killing people to secure our supply of oil, and in the places like Esmeraldas, and in to people like Kyle Dammitz stealing the breath from their lungs, and spending trillions of dollars to subsidize this industry that's delivering those kinds of results to us? How could we, smart people, get into this kind of a mess? Well, two words: politics and lies. The politics are very simple. In the last dozen or so years, oil and gas companies and the auto industry have dumped $186 million in campaign contributions into federal, congressional, and presidential races. $186 million. And you know what they got back for that? For every one of those $186 million, they got back $1,000 in subsidies, tax breaks, or other money that came back into their coffers. So if you could put in a dollar somewhere and get back $1,000, wouldn't you keep doing it? Well, $186 million buys an awful lot of tax breaks and graft, and that's how we got into this problem. But the second problem, the second part of the problem, is lies. The oil and auto industry have lied to us for decades. And in fact, they've done it in a manner that is remarkably similar to tobacco companies. Let me share a short passage with you from the book. Between 1920 and 1955, a nation came of age as its stock market crashed and rebounded, its sons and daughters joined the world at war for a second time, and women won voting rights and a share of jobs previously reserved for men. As the nation grew, and grew up, conspirators including General Motors, Firestone Tire, Shell Oil, Standard Oil of New Jersey, now ExxonMobil, and others, conspired to methodically purchase electric rail mass transit systems in 45 U.S. cities including New York, Philadelphia, St. Louis, and Los Angeles. With warlike precision, they converted these systems from electric rail to diesel-powered buses, which were less efficient, dirtier, and more expensive to operate. In 1947, the administration of President Truman filed antitrust lawsuits against these companies, and in 1949, they were found guilty in federal court of violating federal antitrust laws and conspiring to monopolize the sale of buses and force the sale of those buses to public transit agencies. We live with the legacy of that conspiracy to this day, with the diesel-powered buses that are so ubiquitous on our streets and the lack of clean electric mass transit. In fact, just a mile or two from where we're standing and sitting today, many of the red cars, the clean electric light rail cars that were purchased in this conspiracy, were dumped into the Santa Monica Bay, supposedly as fishing habitat, and others were burned. And you know why you don't see light rail tracks going down the streets of Santa Monica anymore, or most of Los Angeles? Because the conspirators also made sure that they ripped up those tracks so that people couldn't go back to clean electric light rail, at least not without massive cost. And those streets were repaved with asphalt that was purchased at taxpayer expense from oil companies. And as I say, we live with the legacy of that conspiracy to this day. And it didn't just end in the 40s or 50s. In fact, that's when it just began. In the 1950s, when tobacco companies were coming under increasing scrutiny because of the harm of their products, the tobacco companies banded together and they formed the Tobacco Institute. And they said, we're going to check our competition at the door on the one issue of the health of cigarettes. We're going to make sure that we share the best science, and we're going to make sure that our products are safe when used as directed. And the record shows they did the exact opposite. The Tobacco Institute was designed to lie to regulators and the public so that they could hide the science and continue to addict millions of Americans and kill thousands of their best consumers. Well, in the same time period, under pressure from regulators, including Supervisor Ken Hahn of Los Angeles, under increasing pressure, the car companies got together. And they said, you know what, we're going to form the Automobile Alliance, and we're going to check our competition at the door on this one issue about what comes out of the tailpipe, and we're going to make sure that our products are safe when used as directed, and that what comes out of a tailpipe is clean and healthy, and we think that if smog is harmful and if it's coming out of our tailpipes, we can solve that problem by working together within one car model year. They said this in 1955. Raise your hand if you think they succeeded. Well, in fact, they didn't succeed because they didn't try. The record shows they formed the Automobile Alliance to do the exact opposite. Just like tobacco, they formed that alliance to hide the science, to lie to regulators, to stall development of things like catalytic converters and alternative energy, and ultimately to steal those alternatives from us, to fight the federal government and states like California on corporate average fuel economy, and to fight the government and regulators on things like the zero emission vehicle mandate, and to take away not just our clean electric mass rail as they had done in the 30s, 40s, and 50s, but to take away alternatives to the automobile and to petroleum fuels. We need not continue to do this. The list goes on, and I talk about many more of these things in the book about how we've been forced to breathe lead. And if you think lead is now out of all gasoline and that we've moved beyond that, when you step outside of this hangar, look up at the airplanes flying overhead and take a deep breath. Do you smell the lead? Well, you should, because it's still in every single gallon of aviation gasoline, despite the fact there are cleaner, healthier, organic alternatives that could be used as additives to aviation gasoline. It's the oil companies that have prevented us from having that. It's the oil companies that have prevented third world countries from taking the lead out of their commercial gasoline, even though we've done it here because we know of the harmful effects of lead. It's the oil companies that have lied to us about octane. If you've ever put high octane or mid octane gas in your car because you thought it would clean your engine or it was better for your car, unless you drive a 12-cylinder high compression sports car, you've been ripped off. And not only did it not do any good for your pocketbook, it takes about 3 runs through a refinery to create a high-octane fuel, which means it created more pollution to put that fuel in your tank. And if your car wasn't designed to use that fuel, you didn't burn it as cleanly as you would have a lower-octane fuel, which means you created more pollution as you drove down the street with that tank of high-octane. So you hurt your wallet and you hurt the environment. And you didn't know it because, according to the FCC, you've been lied to.
The oil companies have been telling us for decades that high-octane fuel will make our cars perform better and perform cleaner, and the exact opposite is true. The list goes on and on. But my friends, we are better than this. We can be better than this. We can declare our energy independence and in doing so, redefine patriotism in the 21st century. And in the book, I talk about two ways to do it. One that the government must do and one that we must do. The one the government must do is, I believe that if the oil and auto companies have acted like tobacco companies in their corporate behavior, and if what comes out of their tailpipes is chemically very similar to secondhand smoke, which it is, then why not treat them like tobacco companies? Take them to court, force them to convert some of their enormous profits back to the taxpayers to pay for health care costs and cleanup costs of pollution, and to invest in clean alternative technologies like the ones right outside this room we're in today. And let's force them to civilize themselves. I'm not trying to put oil or auto companies out of business. I want to civilize them. I want oil companies to use their amazing marketing ability that they've misused all these years to help sell us clean alternative fuels. And I want the oil companies to be selling us clean alternative vehicles. They need to be in business. We need their products. We just don't need the ones they're trying to sell us today. And that brings us to the second part, which is what must we do? Every one of us has got to signal the oil companies and the auto companies that we're not going to take this anymore. And we can do this in a variety of ways, starting today. There's a lot of choices out here of alternative fuel vehicles and other ways of getting from point A to point B, many of which don't involve any kind of fuel whatsoever, bicycles and obviously mass transit, which does require fuel but is much more efficient. There's lots of other things that we can do other than turning the key in a gasoline-powered car. But if you're not ready to trade in the car, if unfortunately you're addicted because of what these oil and auto companies have done, and you need a vehicle to get your kids to school, to get to work, to carry things around for your job, whatever it is, if you've got to have that petroleum-powered car, you can go out today and do something that most Americans forget to do. 90% of the tires on the cars in this parking lot and everywhere else are underinflated because we don't check our tires very often. And that underinflation costs you 2 to 3% of your fuel economy. So you can strike a blow for energy independence on the way home today by just having your tires inflated. And even if you drive an electric car, you know that electric car's got to get recharged. The electricity comes, by and large, from fossil fuels. So inflating your tires on your electric car will still strike a blow for energy independence. And if you look in the book, I cite a number of other examples of driving tips and things you can do no matter what kind of car you drive to save 10 or 20 or even more, 30%, of your fuel economy. And if you do these things, imagine if everyone did it overnight and we slashed our petroleum dependence by 10 or 15 or 20% literally overnight. What a step in the right direction that would be. And then, of course, we've got to evolve to something better. So you as consumers, as the people who are here at an alternative fuel car expo, you are the vanguard that will help popularize the technology we see in the next room and will be the early adopters, the inventors of the future. I applaud every single one of you. But the reality is, it's not up to us to just make our changes in our own lives. I believe it's up to us to teach others how to do the same. That's the real question here. Who among us will be the first to say that I can change my life a little, that my children will have a better life to live? Who among us will be the first to say that my life will not only be measured by the number on the bottom of a balance sheet, but by the balance of clean air and clean water and healthy landscapes that I bequeath to my children? Who among us will be the first to teach our children to answer the call to action that rang out across this land four decades ago when a president of these United States challenged us to ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country? So I'm here today to ask you to do for your country even more than you're already doing by being here and by all the things I know you already do. Because as is implied in President Kennedy's admonition, we need to not just change our own behavior, but help others do the same. And if this is the day we embrace that idea, if this is the day we act upon that idea, and if this is the day we teach that to others, then this is the day we redefine patriotism in the 21st century and when we will be counted among the greatest American patriots of all time. Thank you for being here. Thank you for what you do. I don't see Tracy, our organizer. I'm not sure if we have a little more time. I'm happy to take a couple of questions. Five, 10 minutes?
10 or 15 minutes.
Great. Thank you.
Proposition 87 and
The question is about Prop 87, the recent ballot measure here in California, which would have put a small severance tax on oil taken from state lands. And by the way, California is the only state in the nation that has an oil industry that does not charge such a severance tax. Very minor, would not have shown up on your gasoline bill, or if it would have been, it would have been a penny a gallon, a nominal amount. And the oil companies spent $96 million to try to defeat that by filling the airwaves with misleading advertising. You know, it was not a perfect measure, but it was a step in the right direction. We have history of how these public goods charges, in other words, where you take a little bit of money from a couple of sources, aggregate it, and then invest that in new technologies. We know it works because you may not know it, but there's a public goods charge like that on your electricity bill, and it raises hundreds of millions of dollars a year, and that's been invested over time in energy efficiency technologies. And that, in turn, over the last 30 years, has made California 40% more electric energy efficient than the rest of the nation. You, per capita, are more energy efficient in California than the rest of our countrymen in the United States because of those investments. This would have done the same, and it's unfortunate that that more people didn't get behind it and get the truth out, as this gentleman suggested. And it's unfortunate that oil companies spent $96 million to lie to us and scare consumers from supporting it. I would take issue with one small thing you said, and that is, I think the oil companies lost. They won nominally. They spent $96 million and they defeated the measure. But you know what? Every time they take a step in that direction, they're guaranteeing their own demise. They're making tons of money now. They're converting these natural resources to cash. But if they don't invest in these alternative technologies, they won't have the products to sell in the future. And I got to tell you, when a guy like Bill Gates invests $100 million in an ethanol plant in the Central Valley, it's not just the oil companies that can play in this game. Other questions? Yes, sir, in the back. It's a very, very good question. The apartheid movement was, I think, in part ended in South Africa because of the shareholder efforts to divest themselves and to have pension funds divest themselves of investments of companies that did business there. That's a great model. In the book, which, by the way, in a couple of minutes, I'm going to be out here right outside the door here at the bookstore there signing copies of the book if you'd like to get one. But in the book, I mentioned that as a strategy. I think something like wartime allocation of fuels and rationing is something that we might want to consider so that people understand the real value of these products and stop wasting them and stop polluting. And it might raise the cost in the short term, but in the long term, we will benefit from it. There's a whole host of more radical ideas that we may have to consider. As I say, I think the one that we should start with, and our Attorney General has, in fact, already started with, is holding these companies accountable for their tobacco-like behavior. About 3 months ago, the Attorney General filed suit against the six major automakers for contributing to global warming and seeks compensation to the state for the cost of dealing with global warming. Now, that's a very small bite of the apple, but if that makes it through the court system, you can see the oil companies becoming the next defendants and health care costs and other things being compensated back from these companies as well. So I think we've got to civilize them, and that's an excellent idea. People can do this. You know, the pension funds didn't divest themselves of apartheid stocks until a lot of individuals did and until there were shareholder resolutions from thoughtful people. So this has got to come from the ground up. What time for one more question, maybe? All right, yes, sir. Right. You know, so there's a lot of different government policies out there, and frankly, government is not necessarily always the best way to get things done, not the paragon of efficiency or effectiveness. But I do think that government has a role to play because, unfortunately, as the book documents, we're spending hundreds of billions of dollars a year subsidizing the oil and auto industry. So we either need to take away those subsidies, which is what I would vote for, or we need to fairly subsidize the other competing industries, because right now we're being told, you know, battery electrics don't compete, biofuels don't compete, hydrogen certainly doesn't compete. Well, as my book documents, we're actually spending about $10 a gallon for every gallon of gasoline we buy. You only pay $3 at the pump, but you pay the other $7 in other places. If you fully load a gallon of gasoline with the true cost, if you take away these subsidies, that levels the playing field for these alternatives in a hurry. But failing that, and given the entrenched nature and the $186 million of campaign contributions that oil and auto industries enjoy in Washington, a more realistic approach is to try to figure out ways to subsidize these emerging technologies. Prop 87 would have done that, but failing that, let's find other ways to do it, other ways to give tax incentives to these emerging technologies and level the playing field that way. I want to thank you all for being here, and I want to say this. William Shakespeare usually finds a way to summarize best, so I'll put it in his words. He said that nature's bequest gives nothing, but doth lend. And so when nature calls thee to be gone, what acceptable legacy canst thou leave? I think if we all make this our life's work, as many of you have, ending our oil addiction within this generation, that's a legacy of which even William Shakespeare would be proud. Thanks for all that you're doing. Thanks for listening.